Let's talk about Jesus, the King of Kings is He, the Lord of Lords supreme throughout eternity. The great I am, the way, the truth, the life, the door. Let's talk about Jesus. More and more. Let's talk about Jesus. The King of Kings is He. The Lord of Lords supreme throughout eternity. The great I am, the way, the truth, the life, the door. Let's talk about Jesus more and
you're celebrating Father's Day today, and you're thankful for the gift of fathers because they are a gift from God. And I thank you for my family, my wife, because they make us look better than what we probably are, you know, with the love of Christ, you know, it's great. So thank you, Dad. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for that. Let's sing that again.
Thank you, Lord. For saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so rich.
Sing the next one, Sherry, 44.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul. Rejoice, take joy.
You Hey, are we on?
Starting there now.
Turn it up a little more. See what we get. Oh, there we go. Now we're starting. Okay. All right. Well, it's not good if you can't hear the pastor, I tell you what. But well, as I was saying, we're glad you're here. Whether you're on site, in the building, out in the parking lot, joining us over video, either on Facebook or at our web church website, we're glad you're here. As I mentioned, we have folks listening from Quebec, Nova Scotia, Alberta, all the way down to Mexico City. And we just praise the Lord for the opportunity to share with you and to share together. As we worship together, as we listen together, as we praise the Lord. Our first song on your song sheet, if you didn't get a song sheet, please get one from the back. It's the tune you'll know. The tune, of course, is How Great Thou Art. And so why don't we stand together and sing this song with these different words. O mighty God, when I behold the wonder. Let's sing together.
O mighty God, when
about that. We want you to fill our hearts, minds, and souls with that love today. so that we can become and continue to, on the journey to becoming who you call us to be. People who are filled, renewed, restored to the image you have want us to be restored to. God, we praise you for your love. We thank you for the opportunity we have to use singing as a way of worshiping and connecting with you and then helping to encourage each other. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your great love for us. Amen. Amen. If you'd like to be seated, you may. If you want to stay standing, well, there's a couple of songs here on Father God. But you can sit if you want. You go ahead and sit. Or if you want to stay standing, that's all right. It is Father's Day, and we think of the greatest Father, of course, our Heavenly Father. Let's sing this song together.
Father God, I give all thanks and praise to Thee. Father God, my hands I humbly raise to Thee for your mighty power and love amazes me, and I stand.
Try this song. The verse says, my hands I humbly raise to thee, which, you know, is a symbol of surrender, right? You know, we see in the movies or whatever, people put their hands up and surrender. I surrender, you know, hands up, you know. That is a symbol of surrender, but it's also a symbol of just saying, Lord, I want whatever you have for me to fill me. And so I want us to sing two more times through this song, but let's use my voice I humbly raise to thee and my heart I humbly raise to you. Let's try that. My voice.
Father God, I give all thanks and praise to Thee. Father God, my voice I humbly raise to Thee for your mighty power and love. Amazes me, and I stand in awe and worship Father God.
My heart this time.
Father God, I give all thanks and praise to Thee. Father God, my heart I humbly raise to Thee.
Lay my life before you. Again, it's that song of surrender. But you know, in surrender, there's victory. There always is when it comes to our relationship with our Heavenly Father. Let's sing together.
Father, I adore you. Lay my life before you.
Seated, please. Just a couple of announcements, and then we'll go back to some more singing. Number 130 in the hymn book. All right. Let's see. What is that song? A Child of the King. Yes. All right. Let's sing that one. Those of you outside, maybe just have to listen in a little bit as we sing this song, unless you have a hymn book in your vehicle, which would be all right too. Let's sing together.
My riches untold. I'm a child of the King, a child of the King. With Jesus my Savior, I'm a child of the King. My Father's own Son, the Savior of men, once wandered on earth as the poorest of them, but now he is reigning forever on high, and will give me a home in heaven by and by. I'm a child of the King, a child of the King. With Jesus my Savior, I'm a child of the King. I once was an outcast stranger on earth, a sinner by choice and an alien by birth, but I've been adopted, my name's written down, an heir to a mansion, a robe and a crown. I'm a child of the King, a child of the King. With Jesus my Savior, I'm a child of the King. A tent or a cottage, why should I care? They're building a palace for me over there. Though it's exile from home, yet still I may say, Savior, I'm a child of the King.
Amen. Amen. Well, last week we sang a song that to some of you it was not familiar. So I told you last week we're doing it again this week. And so we're going to do that. And again, it's really about God's love for us. Thank you, Brother Robert, for sharing that with us. It's so much of the Father's love for us. And sometimes we don't know how to actually appropriate that, how to really take a hold of that. And we need to just hear it over and over again. Let's sing the story about God's word.
Hear the story from God's word, that kings and priests and prophets heard. Word.
say something, brother?
All right.
We can certainly have an experience of a victory in the Lord, even when we do not so smart things. As Irene Coburn in Pembroke always said, she didn't end up in the hospital very often, but anytime she knew she was heading to the hospital, she'd say, "Lord, let me be wise enough and see clearly enough for whatever appointment you have for me with someone at the hospital, whether it be in the emerge, whether it be in a room she had to stay in." She always looked for an appointment God may have for her in that situation. And she said every time there was someone that she met that needed prayer, that needed encouragement, that just she could minister to, even though she was, you know, needing physical help herself. She was ready and willing to give whatever kind of spiritual help to somebody else. So God can turn any situation into an opportunity for us to shine for Him, to shine out Jesus, for sure. One more song, and it's about God's love and Christ's love for us, about Jesus going to the cross. And the first thing that you said, that I don't know if everybody heard it, but you said this little cut in my hand, which wasn't just little, it was what, 8 stitches?
Yes.
8 stitches. That's nothing compared to dying on the cross. Hey, the pain that Jesus went through for us. That's what this song is about. Oh, how He loves you and me. Let's sing together.
Oh, how He loves you.
God, for that reminder again of just how much He loves us. Thank you, guys. Well, this was once found written in a Father's Day card by a son. "Dad, everything I know I learned from you, except for one thing that I learned on my own. The family car can do 125 miles an hour. Here are some responses that people gave to the question, who are fathers? A father is a thing that is forced to endure childbirth without anesthetic. A father is a thing that growls when it feels good, laughs very loud when it's scared half to death. A father never feels entirely worthy of the worship in a child's eyes. He's never quite the hero his daughter thinks, never quite the man his son believes him to be, and this worries him sometimes, so he works hard to try and smooth the rough places in the road for those of his own who will follow him. A father is a thing that gets very angry when the first school grades aren't as good as he thinks they should be. He may scold his child, although he knows very well that it's the teacher's fault. Fathers are people who give their daughters away to other men who aren't nearly good enough so that they can have grandchildren who are smarter and more good-looking than anybody else's. That's a father. As a picture of a father who fulfilled his responsibility, we're going to take a look at Abraham this morning. There's a very important passage in the book of Genesis, chapter 18. If you want to turn there and follow along with me, I find it's really, really helpful if you're able to turn in there, either in your phones. I thought it was wonderful. One day I had a lady up in Pembroke who kind of made herself the overall quality control person in church. And that's just a nice way of saying it. Anyway, she came up to me after church and said, "Pastor, do you know there are some young people playing on their phones during church?" And I said, "Oh, dear. They're not playing on their phones. They actually have their Bible on their phone." Well, it just blew her mind. She didn't know what to do. She turned and walked away. You know what? You get your phones out and look on your phones at your Bible. It doesn't matter what translation or version you're using. I use the New American Standard Bible. It seems to me to be the closest that we can get in the English to the original languages, at least for both Old and New Testaments. And but anyway, chapter 18, where the Lord is speaking about Abraham and whether or not he should tell him about what he's going to do to the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. And while you're turning in your Bibles to Genesis 18, let me ask, have you ever wondered why God chose Abraham? I mean, there had to be hundreds, if not thousands, of men Abraham's age all over the world that God could have picked. Out of all these, God chooses one man. Is it an unknown mystery why God chose Abraham? Actually, no, it isn't. Because God himself tells us why he chose that one man, Abraham, to be the head of his new people group, on which all the salvation of all other people groups would depend. Let's read it from Genesis 18, starting at verse 17. The Lord said, "Shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do, since Abraham will surely become a great and mighty nation, and in him all the nations of the earth will be blessed? For I have chosen him, so that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that the Lord may bring upon Abraham what he has spoken about him." It's there. Did you hear it? Let me reread verse 19, the first part. "I have chosen him so that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice." First, let's look at the meaning of Abraham's name. I think this is really quite important to the discussion of us discovering some things about not just fatherhood. As I mentioned earlier, there are others who have positions of influence over children, whether it's a coach, a big brother, an uncle. I mean, there are all kinds of ways. I mean, we had folks in our family. I don't know if you had folks that are connected to your family that you call aunt and uncle, but they really aren't your aunt and uncle. Okay. And I can remember one gentleman who we called him uncle. And I'll tell you what, I loved every time we got to be around him and to see him. He was younger than most of the adults in my life, although we called him uncle. And he was strong, he was kind, and kids just loved to be around him. And he loved to show off a little bit, you know, do feats of strength and stuff. And I always thought, oh, such a cool guy, right? But just the way he treated others around him, especially women, always a gentleman, always courteous. I thought, you know, I want to be like him too. There's an influence that you can have as a male within children's lives around you. So when I say father, think of yourself. If you aren't a personal dad, think of the influence that you may have in your life for youngsters around you. We're going to look at keeping your place in chapter 18. Let's turn back to the beginning of chapter 17. We're going to read the first 5 or 6 verses here. Now, when Abram, that's still the same guy, okay, just before his name got changed, when Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and I will multiply you exceedingly." Abram fell on his face and God talked with him, saying, "As for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham." For I have made you the father of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings will come forth from you. Now, in most Bibles, you will find a small italicized letter or number either in front of or behind the names Abram and Abraham. Now, if you look down at the bottom of the page or in the margin somewhere, you'll see a corresponding verse number and the corresponding italicized letter with the explanation. Abram means, does anybody have that? Abram means exalted father. Yes. Abraham means father of multitudes or father of many. Yeah. Notice that in both forms, the important fact is that Abram or Abraham is a father. Yet even now, in this chapter, how old did he say he was?
99.
He's got no children yet. Huh. Now, that was the first thing we discovered in this passage. The second thing is that fatherhood, when its duties are carried out properly, builds a strong nation. God said of Abraham, he will surely become a great and mighty nation. Why? Because Abraham could be relied on to fulfill his duty and obligation as a father. Now, thirdly, what did God see in Abraham that made him choose him? Back to chapter 18 now, verse 19. I have chosen him so that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that the Lord may bring upon Abraham what he has spoken about him. God saw that Abraham would command or direct his family well. Now, the word used here is a military term, and I can almost hear some wives and moms going, wait a minute, Pastor. Are you saying my husband or the father of our children has the right to be a dictator in our home? Nothing could be further from the truth. When we look at an idea in the Bible, we have to look right across the Bible to get the full picture and understanding of what God is trying to say. In Ephesians 5:25, we hear this: husbands, love your wives as just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her. Later on in that chapter, it says, or in chapter 6, it says, fathers, do not exasperate your children. In other words, don't provoke them to anger, another translation, right? This doesn't sound like dictatorship, does it?
No.
Not really, no. You see, men, your wife and or children are not your servants to fulfill your wishes or commands. You and I are to act like Christ in our homes. He was a servant leader. God chose Abraham because he would direct his family well, not be a dictator. Let me read again from Ephesians 5. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her. Verse 28, so husbands also ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ also does the church. Certainly no dictatorship here. God tells us that he picked Abraham because Abraham would command or direct his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice. Do you notice? Keep the way of the Lord, not by telling them what was right and wrong. I don't know if you caught that in this verse. He says by doing, what was it he said? By keeping the way of the Lord, by doing righteousness and justice. Let me tell you, values are caught, not taught. You can tell your kids, even your grandkids, your nieces and nephews, this is what you should do. Don't do this. But they're going to watch you. They're going to see what you're doing. And that's, did you know that by the age of 7, boys already have learned the pattern of how to drive based on who's driving the vehicle? Girls, it's age 9. Yeah. They've already learned the pattern of how do I know this? Well, I mean, studies. I actually heard a study done by somebody who I don't know how they figured this out, but the pattern of how they're going to drive is starting to be already set for boys at age 7, girls at age 9, just by watching who is ever driving their car the majority of the time. Isn't that wild? You say, that's driving a car. What about other things? in our lives. Hey? How much we need to have God's wisdom here. Husbands, fathers, your home is not your kingdom to do as you please. It is God's. He is the rightful and final authority. But God has placed you there to direct or command. Again, we're not talking about acting like a dictator. We are talking about a man who's a real man, a man who understands his position and awesome responsibility under God's watchful eye. There are some situations in which a man under God is responsible to direct his household. He's responsible to say, in some situations, in order to please God and have his blessing, this is the way we are going to go. This is what we are going to do or not do. Now, let me just break here and take a minute to address those women who have had or who have had to in the past or now or are now raising their children on their own. God the Father has made special provision for you in that he has promised to be a husband to the widow and a father to the fatherless. We commend you for the work that you have done or are doing now to direct your household. Let me just pray for you right now. Father, I pray for every single woman who either has had to or is now raising children on their own. God, that's just a really huge responsibility and a really tough challenge at times. Father, I pray blessing on them, especially those who are right now having to raise children on their own. Father, would you be that husband to the widow, the father to the fatherless in that situation? Bring blessing to bear on those children. Father God, we pray in Jesus' name. Well, let's go back to Genesis 18, if we could. Did you notice something in the very last part of that verse 19? Let me read the verse again. For I have chosen him, that's God chose Abraham, so that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that, underline, circle, whatever, those two words, so that, what? The Lord may bring upon Abram what he has spoken about him. That's blessing that God wants to bring on Abraham. God has spoken the blessing. God wants it to become a reality in Abraham's life. Abraham's ability as a father is directly connected to the blessings that God promised him before. Isn't that cool? Abraham's ability as a father is directly connected to the blessings that God has promised him. Fathers, grandfathers, God has blessings that he will give you as you fulfill your responsibility to honor him in the way you direct your children, your grandchildren, and let me add here again, all men who have some kind of influence, whether that be an uncle, a big brother, a coach. Coaches have such a huge responsibility in helping children to form and mold. And so I'm not, when I say fathers, I'm not excluding anybody. I'm just saying anybody as a male who has influence, some ability to have positive influence in the life of a younger person. Let me draw a contrast from Abe's personal surroundings to what God said, here's what you should do, here's how you should live, as opposed to this other person in Abraham's own personal surroundings. There was another man that went along with Abraham. His name? Do you remember? Lot. Yes. Lot. That was Abraham's nephew. But there came a time for the two of them to part company because their flocks and herds were too large for them to graze on the same land and drink at the same wells. Well, we pick up the story in chapter 13, Genesis 13, verse 8. So Abram, this is before God changed his name to Abraham. Abram said to Lot, please let there be no strife between you and me, nor between my herdsmen and your herdsmen. For we are brothers. Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. If to the left, then I will go to the right. Or if to the right, then I will go to the left. Lot lifted up his eyes and saw all the valley of the Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere. That this was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt as you go to Zoar. That must be a pretty beautiful land, or it was at one time. So Lot chose for himself all the valley of the Jordan, all the nice, green, lush, beautiful area. And Lot journeyed eastward. Thus they separated from each other. Abram settled in the land of Canaan, rock, desert, scrubland, maybe not as nice, quote unquote. While Lot settled in the cities of the valley and moved his tents as far as Sodom. One translation says, pitched his tents facing Sodom. Now the men of Sodom were wicked exceedingly and sinners against the Lord. By the time we get to chapter 18, that was chapter 13. By the time we get to chapter 18, God has decided that the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah had to be dealt with for all of their wickedness. And guess where Lot, Abraham's nephew, is living? In Sodom. God specifically warns Lot that he's going to destroy the place. And Lot tries to convince his sons-in-law to get out. But he failed. As Lot escaped, barely, he must have realized that many of his own family had been destroyed and that he alone was responsible for them being there in that city. Let me say this. Too many fathers have led their children into a Sodom, a place of wickedness, but couldn't lead them out again. What a fearful responsibility rested on the shoulders of Lot as a father. There's a fellow by the name of Jack. I met him years ago. This just popped into my brain. And Jack and I were talking about his growing up years. And he said his parents loved to go to the bar. He was the youngest of, I don't know how many, 8 kids. And he said he can remember spending hours in the back seat of the car while his parents were in the bar, drinking till they were so drunk they hardly knew what they were doing, and then they'd drive home. He said it was only God's grace that ever got them home without a fatal accident of some sort or killing somebody else. But he can remember that Friday nights in the back, laying down the back, even in the winter, laying down the back seat of the car. And that was his life growing up as his parents went in the bar. And he said it was only God's grace that actually, again, like Robert, you shared with us, only God's grace that ever brought him to the cross, to Jesus Christ in saving knowledge.
That's how we learned how to drive.
What's that?
That's how we learned how to drive.
That's how you learned how to drive. Because?
Driving my dad home.
Driving your dad home. Wow. Ouch. Hey, what a fearful responsibility rested on the shoulders of Lot as a father. He led his children into a place of sin and ultimate judgment and couldn't get them out again. I believe this has been one of Satan's major schemes, strategies against families and fathers in our nation. Suppose a father fails at his role, what happens to his family? Or suppose that fathers of a nation fail, what happens to the nation? You don't need to turn there, but in Deuteronomy 28, God gives Moses 2 lists. There's a list of blessings if the children of Israel obey, and there's a list of curses if they disobey. The first 14 verses of Deuteronomy 28 list the blessings. The first 14 verses. The next 54 verses outline the curses for disobedience of not walking in God's way and keeping his law. Now, before I go any further, we're going to look at a couple of verses out of there. Before I go any further, I can almost hear somebody saying, I don't know why preach is reading this. We're under grace. We're not under law. Before you turn your brain off, let me explain something about grace and law. Too often preachers have, and writers have, written a theology that suggested that law and grace are beside each other. Law over here on the one side of the pulpit, grace over here on the other side of the pulpit, and people that, well, I used to be under law when I was a sinner. Now I ask God to forgive me. I'm under grace, and it doesn't matter what I do over here. Grace covers everything. It doesn't matter one little bit.
Not true.
It's not true. And that's never what the Bible tells us. Right? The Bible in its entirety, and the New Testament especially, helps us understand that the picture is this. Grace here and law underneath. If I fall below the level of grace, which is to love God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and my neighbor as myself, I immediately come under law. If I fall below the level of grace, I come under law. That's why we need to know what the law says. To help us, kind of like, kind of like my dad said, here's the law in this house. You fall below that, you know, you live above that, you're in grace. You fall below that, you're going to feel the effects of the law. Yeah. I remember one Sunday saying that I had more than a few wooden spoons broken over my backside, and one young lady, she was about 14, sitting in church here, her mouth dropped open. Wide open. Yeah. You know what? It may have hurt physically for a while, but it didn't hurt me overall. Anyway, you fall below the level of grace, you come under law. So in Deuteronomy 28, there are many remarkable curses listed, but I want to highlight just one in verse 41. One of the curses: you shall have sons and daughters, but you will not enjoy them, for they will go into captivity. Not enjoying our kids is a curse. I don't know how many parents in North America and all over the world really enjoy their children. Granted, now listen carefully, some kids, no matter what you do, no matter how you try to direct them or train them, it seems as though there will never be a place you can sit together and experience true enjoyment. I mean, they're responsible for their own choices. And some make choices that go completely against what you tried to direct them away from or direct them toward, no matter how hard you tried. I get that. I mean, we're experiencing that in our own lives, Diane and I personally, right now. But God gives children as one of the greatest blessings He could give a husband and wife. And when fathers and mothers, but especially fathers, don't walk in the way of the Lord, then that blessing is no longer a blessing. Moses warns the fathers of Israel that if they do not keep God's way and walk in it, so that's the walk and the talk lining up together, their children will go into captivity. Will, and I put air quotes on go into captivity. Moses was talking about a literal captivity. But in our day and age, we're seeing generations of kids going into just as real a captivity. The captivity of poverty, addictions, materialism, moral relativism, and the captivity of sexual confusion, which I call disorientation, not sexual orientation. I call it sexual disorientation. Why have these millions, even billions of children gone into captivity? The answer is given in the Bible. Because to a large degree, fathers have failed in their responsibilities. The primary responsibility for the state of affairs among our young people in Canada rests at the doors of fathers. We hear a lot about juvenile delinquents. I think it was some wise person, I'm just quoting them, says there are hardly any juvenile delinquents until there are first adult delinquents. What can be done, if anything? Well, the last book of the Old Testament is Malachi, and from there we read this. Remember the law of Moses, my servant, even the statutes and ordinances which I commanded him in Horeb for all Israel. Behold, I am going to send you Elijah, the prophet, before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. He will restore the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, so that I will not come and smite the land with a curse. Do you ever realize the last word in the Old Testament is curse? Yeah. What can be done to avoid the curse? Verse 6 says, the prophet Elijah will return the hearts, and he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. How desperately we need the hearts of fathers turned toward their kids and then the hearts of the children toward their fathers. How can that happen? Well, through a lot of hard work in prayer and action. Children and teens, I say this, pray for your dads or the other significant men in your lives. You say, oh, I don't want to pray for him. You know what? Pray to God anything you want to about your dad or the man of influence in your life. If it's not positive, let God know. He can handle it. But pray. Because here's what I know will happen. If you're praying for your dad or other men of influence in your life in a negative way, sooner or later, God's going to start teaching, convicting you and teaching you how to pray in a positive way. Wives, pray for your husbands. Notice I said not about, but for. There's a difference. Pray for your husbands, whether they are a father or grandfather, not even a father yet, or are a man of influence in others' lives, a father figure. Pray that their heart would be truly turned toward the children. Other women in the church, pray for the dads and granddads that you know. Pray for both conviction and wisdom. And I say conviction. Pray for conviction that where they aren't doing it right, where they know they're going a wrong way, they'll be convicted to come back to truth and stand in truth. And then pray for wisdom to know what they should do or what they shouldn't do. Single moms, pray that God will fill the space as father that has been left empty. Ask God to keep on providing godly men who might positively influence your child or children. And what about grandfathers? Pray that God would teach you how to turn your heart toward your adult children and your grandchildren. I don't know all of the stuff that's gone on. You know, sometimes I was talking with somebody recently as a dad of all adult children, and there's friction and not talking happening there between one of their adult children. And I just keep trying to encourage, say, keep praying for them. Keep finding ways to express some kind. I don't know why he or she isn't talking to me. You know what? Just do what you can. Meet better than halfway. Try it. If they still won't communicate, you just keep doing whatever you believe God wants you to do and leave the rest of the results in his hands. Finally, dads, let me read one father's prayer for enlightenment. Dear Heavenly Father, can you forgive me for hurting my children? I came from a poor background, so I thought that a big house would make my kids feel important. I didn't realize that all it would take was love. I thought that money would bring them happiness, but all it did was make them think that things were more important than people. Oh God, I thought that using a rod would make them tough so they would defend themselves. All it did was make me stop seeking wisdom so I could carefully discipline them and teach them the way they should go. And God, I thought that leaving them alone would make them independent. All it did was force my oldest to parent my youngest. I thought that by smoothing things over, all the family problems over, I was keeping the peace. All I was teaching them was to run rather than lead. Oh, Father God, I thought that by pretending to be a perfect family in public, I was bringing them responsibility. All I was teaching them was to live a lie and keep secret. I thought that all I had to do to be a father was to make money, stick around the house, supply all their material needs. All I taught them was that there was a better way of being a dad. The problem, Lord, is that they will have to guess at what being a real dad is. And dear God, I hope you can read this prayer as I write it. My tears have smudged a lot of the words on the page. Amen. Fathers, men of influence, God has given us an awesome responsibility. Do we always get it right? No. Is there room for improvement? Yes. As a matter of fact, that's the biggest room in the world. So pray. Pray and ask God to show you what it would mean to turn your heart toward the child or children in your life. Get specific. Ask God for specifics. Ask God to show you one area that you could begin to improve on this week. One thing that will help you by the power of the Holy Spirit to turn your heart just a little more in the direction of your child, grandchild, other children of influence that you have influence in. One area that will help you become like Father Abraham, who directed his children and his household to keep the way of the Lord by doing what was right and just. You see, the power of the Holy Spirit can make you what you ought to be. This is where the blessing will be found. Let's pray. Father God, you are the ultimate picture of Father. But thank you for the picture we've been able to see in Abraham today. Help us to be able to take what you want us to take away from today and become who we can become through the power of your Holy Spirit. Oh, Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you are the one who can lead us and give us wisdom by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. Thank you. Amen. Would you stand with me as we sing our closing song? And the chorus of this song, his power can make you what you ought to be. 'Twas best for him to have his way with thee. Let's stand to sing together, please.
Would you live for Jesus and be always pure and good? Would you walk with him? Bear your burden, carry all your load. Let him have his
His love can fill your soul, and you will see 'twas best for Him to have His way. Sing you so that you might never fall. Let Him have His way with thee. His power can make you what you ought to be. His blood can cleanse your heart and make you free. His love can fill your soul, and you will see 'twas best for Him to have His way. His kingdom find a place of constant rest. Would you prove Him true in providential test? Would you in His service labor always at your best? Let Him have His way with thee. His power can make you what you want to be. His blood can cleanse your heart and make
down to three things. Love God, love each other, and then go out there and be the church, even when you end up in hospital. Right, brother? Amen. Amen. God bless you.